course I forgot, over the channel. So we'll consider this tampering experiment, but unfortunately the channel modifies this message C, apply some function f, and on the other end you get this C star. So this is kind of some kind of bad channel. And of course, in information theory and encoding theory, we deal with these channels all the time. What we do, we add a layer of encryption, encoding and decoding, not encryption. There are no secret keys here. So in reality, the message that we want to send is M. So we're going to encode it. We're going to get a code word C. Then the code word C goes to the channel, and then we decode it, and we get some message M star. So this is what we will consider the real setting. That's what will happen in real life. So we'll try to design some kind of clever encoding and decoding function. Hopefully M star will be equal to M, but I don't want to get there yet. So this is kind of what will happen in reality when we're dealing with this communication channel. And what we'd like to consider is to compare it with the idealized setting, where there is hopefully some simpler function G, and we don't need to apply encoding, and then essentially instead of the message M, we get this message G of M, where G is some kind of good channel. So in general, red is going to consider something kind of bad and alarming, and green will be denoting something kind of nicer and good. All right. And what we would like to say is that for appropriate choices of F and G, that the real setting is somewhat looks like the ideal setting. Right. So I'll make it a little bit kind of more formal as we move along, but this is a picture that is good to keep in mind throughout this talk. All right? So, am I moving forward? Okay, so what are the properties? So the correctness property is obvious. So intuitively, if f is an identity function, we would like the decoding message to be the same. So so the correctness applies to the real setting. So our encoding and decoding function shouldn't destroy the message if there is no tampering, right? So if f is identity, everything is good. So this is about the obvious property. What about the security? Security, I will call it for the purposes of this talk, I'll call it simulation. And intuitively, I would like to say is that for any real kind of complicated tampering function that happens on the real setting, there exists a good tampering function in the ideal setting such that essentially the real will look like the ideal, just like I talked about, right? And so the goal, of course, is why don't we just ignore encoding, decoding, make f equals g? Well, of course, the point is that we, the real situation, the function family f, this script f, the red f, it's something realistic and large. It contains like kind of nasty functions. And the green setting hopefully will be really small and nice, something that we can deal with directly. All right, so this is a definition. Essentially, that's the only definition we'll need, essentially for the rest of the talk, and we'll play with various choices of f and g. Okay, so just to give you some kind of simple example, we will say in this case that encoding deck is a tampering reduction from nasty realistic kind of channel F to a nice, channel G. Okay, and the notation will sometimes denote F kind of reduces to G, right? So essentially just tells you that in order to deal with F, using this encoding and decoding, we reduces it to dealing with a much simpler and nicer channel G. All right, so hopefully the notation is clear. So let's try to connect it. And there is a small kind of subtlety, but it's, of course, it's kind of very important in these results. If the encoding is probabilistic, sometimes for some settings we don't need probabilistic encodings, for some settings we will kind of assume that the choice of the tampering, realistic tampering F is independent of this randomness. All right, so it's like a small subtlety. All right, so let's just get back to stuff that we know because it was a little bit too abstract. Yeah?
There is no shared randomness in Encke and
Def, and so in this setting it's kind of weird why we would need probabilistic thing if Encke and Def don't share any randomness, so we'll see. Alright, so we will see why it's kind of inherent. Oh, sorry. Something is wrong with this. Maybe it's like my guy also is trying to time me. Okay, so let's try to revisit stuff that we know. And this time we'll start with the simplest family of nice channels. So that's the family of error-correcting codes. This family just consists of the identity function. So namely, our goal in the ideal setting is to recover the message. So we don't allow anything else. We actually want to recover the message. So we want to only allow identity function. And in this case, of course, there are various error correcting things that we consider. But usually to get any feasibility results, we assume that the realistic family F is going to have like a bounded number of errors in the code word with respect to some kind of metric. It could be Hamming errors. It could be some kind of other errors. Right? So in this case, the realistic family is a family that makes a bounded number of errors. And a nice family is identity function, which allows zero errors.
right? And of course, in this case, we have many, many constructions. That's not a point of this talk, but of course, many people who work in information theory worked on like low density parity check codes, all kinds of exciting things, as well as classical codes. So this is well known. So this is not yet the subject of this talk, just kind of the motivation. So we can do something slightly more relaxed. Now we can say, you know what, we want to get more. We want to get even more realistic channels. So what can we get? So one direction here, what if we relax our family of acceptable channels to also contain the bottom function? So in other words, we allow the attacker to destroy the message, but we don't want but at least in this case we detect it. We kind of know that in this case, well, there were too many errors and we just refused to decode, but our only goal is not to never recover a wrong message, right? So this is kind of a relaxation on this side. And even in this relaxation, you immediately get the benefits. For example, even with a standard family FR, we can still do FR, but now we can correct a double amount of errors. Right, because if we need to correct intuitively the errors, we can only do half of minimal distance. But if we only want to detect, we can allow essentially all the way to minimal distance, maybe minus one. So we immediately get the benefits even here. But now we can actually consider once we do this detection family. Just to give you, I'm going to give you some examples before moving to non-malleable codes, just to motivate this notion a little bit. But now we can consider some other families which were previously impossible. For example, like at Eurocrypto 8, we consider this family which initially looked like a bizarre exercise, but it turned out to have a lot of useful applications, is this additive channel. So algebraic manipulation detection channel. So in this case, the kind of tampering functions that they allow is to add a fixed but arbitrary offset delta to the quadrant. So essentially, you can just arbitrarily add anything you want in some metric, let's say bitwise XOR or some kind of other metric, any other group. You can just add a fixed constant, but the constant is independent. You have the tampering function, cannot depend on this C. You can just add arbitrary thing to the message. It could be zero, for example, right? And in this case, you can see so it has many applications. So I will not tell you all this kind of buzzword names. It has applications to fuzzy extractors, secret sharing schemes, and also the subject of this tutorial, which is non-malleable codes, which I didn't define yet. So this family is kind of nice. But here, just to address Salil's question, the randomness of ANC is essential. So because if the encoding is kind of deterministic, for example, the attacker knows, then for every message M, the attacker immediately knows what C is. So the attacker can choose some other valid convert C prime and just make delta to be C plus C prime. And he can like translate encoding, a fixed encoding for one message to a fixed encoding of another message. So here, but by making things kind of randomized, the attacker will not know exactly which codeword it is, and we can kind of ensure that for most offsets, it will be an invalid codeword. So this is kind of an example where seemingly useless kind of randomness is actually essential here. And it's, well, actually we will not see, but as we showed in this paper, very small amount of randomness was sufficient for this application. So we see this power of detection, but now we want to get some more stuff. So for example, in many applications, especially applications to tampering, but also applications to message transmission, especially when we consider what we call like active attackers, one thing the attacker can do is just to kind of ignore, block whatever you're sending and just inject his own message. Right, that's like a very basic capability of the attacker to just or send something on pretending that this is Alice or something like that. He will just send arbitrary message to start. So this corresponds to a constant tampering function. It's just you override the message. If you store something on the hard drive, the attacker can maybe wipe down your hard drive. So it's a pretty basic kind of family. And so this is very realistic, and indeed it has found many applications. But now, if you want to reduce it to this family of error detecting codes, so essentially which is just identity function and bottom, obviously this is impossible, even if the encoding is probabilistic, because, for example, the attacker can just, there are no secret keys, the attacker can compute a valid encoding of arbitrary message M star and just overwrite it, right? So, and obviously, you will, by correctness, you will decode M star, which probably will be different from both the message and the bottom. Right? So this kind of shows, well, we had like a good thing going, but once we start to do some, pretty basic kind of things, there is not much we can do. But fortunately, in cryptography, so this is like the side of impossible. We don't like impossibility results. So, so the way we kind of interpret it, over here, is we never give up. All it tells us that, in this tampering, you can override the message by a constant. So all this tells us that we just need to extend our function, the set of acceptable channels to include constant functions. For now, it's not clear whether it's bad or good, but you know, it's clear that if we want to tolerate overrides here in the real setting, we should be able to get overrides in the ideal setting. Let's see how far it gets us. So and that's actually exactly what the definition of non-malleable codes. You kind of so for those of you who are not kind of cryptographers, but maybe heard about cryptography, or people who are beginning to work in cryptography, the word non-malleable is very scary. Even though, of course, well, Moni and Cynthia. Maybe Cynthia is not here. It's very influential. It's like exciting stuff, but usually it's associated with something like really messy and kind of sneaky and like very error prone. But here I kind of guided you through without anything, you know, people who, you know, that to get a formal kind of definition of non-malleable code, right? So it's actually very clean. So you don't have to be afraid of this term. So we'll consider the ideal channel to be exactly what I said. It will consist of identity function and constant functions. I'm not going to put bottom because it's a special case of overwriting function, if you wish. So this is our family of acceptable functions that we want to tolerate. And a non-malleable code is simply a tampering reduction. I guess I'll put it on the next bullet. So non-malleable code, which is introduced in a really cool paper of you know, Dzimbowski, Krzysztof, and Vicks. NF non-malleable code, I mean, they define it as slightly differently because it was crypto influence, but we'll pretend to be information theorists, and this is a definition from information theoretic perspective. It's simply a tampering reduction from F to the family of non-malleable functions, which are kind of trivial functions, which only include identity function and constant functions. All right, so I'll put a picture on the next slides and then take questions, just so that people kind of remember. Yeah, that's very important. Please ask questions. Yes, so you're right. So I'm hiding, this is very good. I'm hiding some parameters. In particular, the only parameter that I'm hiding here is the error probability. And so there is some parameter epsilon, so think about it as like negligible or something small. So yes, there is an error probability. So you're right, for error correcting codes, usually there was an error probability zero. Once you have this error detecting codes and so on, it's essential to have some small error probability epsilon. Usually we will be able to achieve very small epsilon you know, at a very small cost. So essentially, we can achieve arbitrarily small epsilon by tweaking parameters. But I'm going to hide this epsilon. So intuitively, think about it negligible or something like that. Yeah. So there is definitely an error probability that I'm hiding on this slide. So this definition is not completely formal. Well, the epsilon is hidden in this approximate sign. Okay, so let's recap where we got. So this is a definition of non-malleable code. We have a real setting, we have a function family F, we design encoding, decoding, we get M star, and we would like to look at this to look like the setting where essentially that for any F, there exists, well, in general, a convex combination, because attacker can always like flip a coin and say this probability of half, I'm going to let the message through, this probability of a half, I overwrite it. So we can, in generality, there is this convex combination of trivial functions in this family of non-malleable codes, such that real setting looks like the ideal setting. And there are several questions to ask, but perhaps the most important questions before we get into the question of designing non-malleable codes, is it a useful notion? We can design anything, but you know, even though we are mathematicians, we are kind of applied mathematicians, we, you know, we want to make sure that our things are useful for something. So let me address this question. Is it useful for something? And the answer is yes. It has been found many applications. I'll cite them on the last slide also. But just to give you a basic, one of the most basic applications, non-malleable codes. For example, consider you know, some kind of a signature infrastructure using secure tokens. So there is some kind of signing key, you know, all the tokens have the same, let's say, signing key hardwired. That was like in earlier versions of like smartphones and so on. That's what people kind of had. And each token has also a hardwired user ID. And what the token allows you to do legitimately, if you give it a message M, it will sign using this fixed secret key, the message M, but with, you know, with this user ID. So it will sign the message user ID, comma the message. And presumably the token will refuse to accept anything except for the user ID. So imagine that we would like to protect. So here we assume that you cannot tamper with the code, but maybe you can tamper with the secret key and see what kind of happens. So in this case, imagine that you allow to apply a function F to a secret key and observe these legitimate signatures. And the solution is, if we actually on the card, instead of storing the secret key directly, we'll encode it using, so let me, I see Salila's puzzle, so I'll explain it slowly, all right? So so here's what we are going to do, and then, so maybe I'll explain the solution, and then you'll see the problem we are solving. So we are going to take this, the signing key, And we are going to encode it using a non-malleable code. That's how we are going to store it. And when you're going to sign it, you know, first you're going to decode it, and then you're going to sign. Right? That's what you're going to do. But now the attacker kind of applies a function f to what we store. So what we store is encoding. Right? So when the attack applies a function f, we are essentially back to the real model. So because we are using a non-malleable code, again, is a function family f, that's kind of written here, right? So the temper key, this is exactly what happens in the real model. You apply f to what we store, you decode, you get sk star. And by the property of non-malleable codes, we know that either the attacker did nothing, or the attacker completely overwrote it by something completely unrelated signing key. That's what non-malleable codes tell us. Right? And both cases are useless for this application because in either case, even if you are able to sign under this tampered key, but under the user identity, but under this user ID, you cannot forge a valid signature on a user ID prime. Because if the signing key was the same, this follows from unforgeability of the signature schemes, and if the signing key is unrelated, it's even better, it's a totally useless thing. Right? So any questions about this kind of applications, just so that I'll pause here if people want me to comment on the usage. Yeah? Yeah.
Does it change if you allow non-malleable reproduction?
Well, of course. I mean, as we'll see, none of the standard constructions work because, for example, none of the standard constructions are probabilistic. So, you know, we need. So here, for example, randomness is essential. So yeah, it's a new primitive, and everything has to change.
Imagine theorem does a concept called the Shannon capacity of the discrete memory.
Yeah.
So that sort of connects to what you call F core or whatever.
Okay.
G core. Right? I mean, that's basically what you try to do. You try to clean up a channel and replace it.
Yeah.
By the identity channel. So apparently now you're also allowing constants.
Not apparently. It's that's exactly what I do, yes.
Does that change channel capacity?
Yeah, of course. It changes everything. Well, for example, it's not clear if it exists. Well, so everything that primitive was defined in 2010, it's an exciting area. There are like gazillion of open questions, so I definitely encourage people to work. But yeah, it changes everything. So everything you know will not work. You will have to do new machinery.
Yeah. Maybe I'm understanding the question differently. So there's two things you did.
Yeah.
You made the family F bigger compared to the traditional coding setting.
So I made bigger? Yeah. Both F and G bigger, yes.
If you only make G bigger, but keep F the same, is that the question you're asking?
No, I'm not sure he made F bigger, right? So those definitions of F malleable code. So given F, the question is whether you can somehow, maybe in some block framework, convert it into a mixture of these objects which are identical.
Right, but his motivation for making F bigger was. I mean, making G bigger was because
to make F bigger,
included the constants.
At the very least, yeah.
In the
Fs also.
Yeah. So in your traditional thing, if the attacker like overrides something, it's considered the game is over. And here I'm just making a new kind of game changer. The game is not over. Yeah. I'm making, so everything changes,
this,
right?
But, I mean, I was just asking, so it's kind of an orthogonal question, right? So from Shannon theorist, F is basically, say, the class of discrete memory. Channel,
yeah.
Right? And then if you just take G to be the identities, in some sense, what you're doing in coding theory is splitting up the F.
Yeah, sure, of course, yeah. This is my first example,
so
yeah.
Now suppose you also allow, you know, constants.
Right.
My guess is nothing's going to change, but that's just like a 5 minute.
Well, nothing will work, obviously. So so none of the previous solutions, obviously, they will not work completely because, non-malleability is a very subtle thing. So, for example, you would have to argue that from encoding of one message, you cannot get encoding of a message plus one if the number of errors is unbounded. I mean, it's... So essentially, hopefully, we'll see some of the techniques. So I'll answer two things. So the first thing is the stuff that is done in information theory is not useless. Indeed, some of the techniques will use some coding theory. You will see examples like three slides from now. That's one thing. The second thing, it is very meaningful. It has applications to cryptography, so that's good. The tools that information theorists have developed, not Shannon entropy, but like tools from coding theory, are very useful. So this is all positive. The negative, if you have to be open to just accept new definitions, and it's good to connect it to your thing, but you just have to think from the new definition rather than say, oh, I've solved it already. Just take the new definition, make sure you understand it, and then good things will happen. What I'm saying is just make sure you understand it. But as far as I know, yes, you need new techniques in addition to the techniques that information theory guys know. But I think it's an exciting area. I would love if you guys join it. But I think it's new, and the important new thing is the functionality and the meaning of unrelated. It's a very subtle notion. For example, I'll talk about it a little bit, but I think it's information theoretic is good. You don't need to know what negligible functions is.
Everything is information theoretic, and it's all fully defined here. Yeah.
There's also the theory of arbitrarily varying chances.
Yeah.
What are the
connections? So, so here, for example, you cannot allow, as far as I know, none of the stuff that you know would allow you to override the message. So I'm not sure if there is, so tell me if anything that has been studied, I would love to know, information theory allows you to override the message and get some meaningful security guarantee. To the best of my knowledge, this is the first thing that tells you overwriting the message completely is not the end of the world, because usually information theory, wow, you destroy the message, then the end of the game. It's like, as far as I know, it was never been considered, and here I'm saying there is a useful thing. There is a very useful, I'm giving you an example why it's useful, but there are many more. There is a useful security guarantee when the attacker can completely override the message. And that requires, as we'll hopefully see, new techniques in addition to coding techniques. So you will see, hopefully, in like two slides, I'm going to give you an example of non-malleable codes where I will use error correcting codes, but in addition to something else to build it. And hopefully, maybe it will be clear. So let me give you a construction, like in two slides. But I think it's, I mean, I would love if you guys, you know, as I said, it's just, I think it's the wrong, your kind of temptation, how is it related to this and that? I think the right thing is, like, make sure you understand it's seen, you know, some constructions. Once you see what it is, presumably you will see it's not related to anything that you know, but it's still a meaningful thing. So let's just bear with me and let's see the construction. So this is actually next slide, not three slides. So this is like the very first construction of non-malleable code. This is a simplification of the construction from the original paper. But I think it's like the easiest example of non-malleable codes, and you'll see exactly what it is. So let's consider the following family. It's a family of bitwise tampering functions. So for every bit, you can do anything you want, but you have to act independently from bit to bit. So what does it mean, everything, anything you want? Well, normally anything you want, you can copy. You can override 0, 1, and usually anything you want could be negation as well. So I'll disallow negations, just to be kind of simple. So you can either copy a bit, or you can override it. But for each bit, you can do different things. For the even bits, you can override. For the bits, odd bits, you can like put 0, 1s. So this is a family. Sorry. Yeah, you have to announce the family. So initially, you have to tell me for every position which of the three options you have. For each positions, and then I want to protect it. I want to, right? So you can see that it includes constant functions. For example, if you just override, only use overrides, it will include constant functions. It includes identity functions and also includes error correcting codes. For example, like you can choose bounded number of errors. So, but this is presumably the simplest thing to do.
But
so the two.
You have some bound for the
no bound.
Probability of override, no?
No, the attacker can supply arbitrary function. There will be some security, there will be some epsilon. Once I give you the construction, there will be some security epsilon I achieve. It will be like exponentially, like 2 to the minus n or something like that. But I'm just hiding epsilons just to keep it. No, that's the thing. It's like it's, I think it's a game changer in a sense. You really have to look at it from with open eyes. Once you do, I think you will like it. But it's just the reason I'm kind of resisting these kind of questions of connections, because I've done it before. Every time I convinced people, but there was like a 20 minute of unnecessary iteration. Just look with an open mind. Hopefully you will see what's going on, right? That's, yeah. There is probability. Yes, the attacker is deterministic. The probability will be my code construction. The code has to be probabilistic. As I kind of told you, even like on the previous example, it's easy to see that if the code is deterministic, the attacker can always, I mean, if you know exactly what is encoded, the attacker can always make a related thing. It's actually not completely obvious to see, but maybe I'll extend that. So the probability will be over the choice of the encoding.
So there is no concept of channel like in standard?
The channel is adversarial, yes, perfect. Okay, that's actually, thank you. That's actually exactly another very key difference here. We consider, because we want like a stronger security guarantee, we will consider adversarial channels. We'll have to pay for it in terms of rate. Like for example, in standard error-correcting code, you know, theory, if you have like probabilistic channel, you know, there is, it has better capacity, like binary symmetric channel has better, you know, capacity than the channel adversarial channel with the same amount of errors. Not by much, but like a better capacity, because you can use the fact that the errors are random. So here I'm going for a stronger security guarantee. I could, it's not essential. It's just in this example. I could have gone for a weaker guarantee by saying my, I don't know, the attacker is like probabilistic or something like that. I just choose for a stronger one. I will have to pay for the rate for this, but it's, yeah.
In order to quantify it, you put the code, maybe randomize one.
Yeah.
Then the function
Yeah.
Chosen, and then you play.
Yeah, the attacker also chooses a message. Yeah. Yeah, I have to announce the code. It could be probabilistic. The attacker has to choose a function from the family, and then we'll have to run the experiment. And so hopefully, maybe that's actually important. As I said, if you run out of time, don't worry about it. So it's like for any message, the attacker can even choose a message. The function f is also adversarial. There will be mixture just because, as I said, it is true that even for fixed functions, sometimes we'll have a mixture, but for applications, it will be kind of fine. But the randomness is really coming from the randomness of encoding, actually here. So this is good. So let's try to see the example. So the tool that I'm going to use is, you see there is this error correcting word here, is something which is called linear error correcting secret sharing scheme. So let me tell you what it is. It has three properties, and it's an extension of an error-correcting code, which also has a privacy guarantee. So it has three properties. The first property, linearity, you all know from linear error-correcting codes. If you just if you encode two messages, add them up, and try to decode, you get M1 plus M2. So this is simple. Privacy, that's a new guarantee that is more kind of from cryptographic perspective. The encoding will be probabilistic, even with the property that for any message M, if you tell me any t bits of the encoding, t is a parameter that I will say, these t bits jointly look uniform. So let's say if t is like 17, any 17 bits of a code word are random. For every message, there will be enough randomness in the encoding that any t bits of the encoding are random and independent. So you add some noise to confuse the attacker intuitively. All right, and the d-distance is a usual thing, that if you decode anything with non-zero with Hamming weight less than d, decoding is bottom. So there are no valid code words which are low Hamming weight. So this first insert is standard linear error correcting codes, and here we also add the privacy guarantee. This forces randomness in the encoding. So this is our scheme, and the theorem is very cute, I think. I mean, as I said, it's just a simplification of the theorem from the original paper. If the encoding and decoding is a linear error correcting scheme with the following parameter, the relative distance is pretty aggressive. It has to be a quarter. As we'll see, it really has to be a quarter, so it's pretty aggressive, but not impossible. And the privacy has to be just something super logarithmic. So intuitively, our security will be 2 to the minus t. So that's why you just make it. Then this is a non-malleable code. Again, it's this copy and set functions. So I'll just pause to make sure that we get the statement right. And just, I'm not telling you how to construct this. I'm just saying, assume we have this abstraction. I'll point to constructions like two slides from now.
A copy set
is a function where for every bit the attacker can independently do it. There is no bound on number of errors. He can overwrite anything. He can overwrite half. He can, completely arbitrary. So here you see how randomness, we'll see why it's essential very shortly. Right, so this is a construction. So let's try to do the proof. The original papers also do bit flips, and they did something slightly more complicated there, but we'll just do this for now. All right, so let's see the proof. So the proof intuition has four cases, depending on, essentially the relative fraction of overrides and flips. So let's try to go here and see what's happening. So this is our message. We encode it into, in this case, C guys. And then the attacker chooses a function F, which essentially for every position he can do is a red thing, which is like override, or he can do this yellow thing, which is to keep. Right? This is what the attacker can do. So we get this code word, and then we will decode the code word, right? Okay, so in each case, I'm going to tell you, so essentially I'm going to give you four cases. In each case, I will tell you what the resulting message M star is. In each case, it will be either independent or identity. All right, so let's see what are the cases. The first case assumes the attacker overrides almost everything. So he keeps less than, T positions. So T is this parameter that we say. So the attacker keeps less than T positions and overrides more than, Q is the number of things that the attacker overrides. It's almost everything, right? So in this case, what do we know? Well, here we are going to use the privacy. We know that these t positions are actually uniformly random, right? No matter what the original message is, they're uniformly random and independent of the message. Therefore, the result of decoding is completely independent of the message. This is chosen by the attacker, and this is just uniformly random, right? So this is the easy case, right? So is it, all right, so let's do the second. This is the key. How is it? Sorry? G.
Oh, yes. So in particular, I'm telling you what the decoding is. The decoding, which is independent of the message, is take this stuff, pick this stuff at random decode, and you get some constants. So it will be a mixture of constants in this case. And I'm telling you how to generate a mixture of constants. Put the red stuff, sample this at random, independent of the message, decode. That's a perfect question. So as a coding theorist, so indeed, one of the key, so in coding theory, usually the existence results you kind of take for granted, and then you optimize the rate. So here, rate will be very important, and in this case, indeed, I will show you that we can achieve constant rate stuff. So the rate is, you know, the ratio between this and this. Here, I mean, we'll see what is the parameters.
So the preceding theorem did not give you a
Well, I mean, it's whatever linear correcting secret sharing is. So the rate is exactly the rate of this, and on the once I give you the proof, I'll tell you what is known.
The question is whether such a thing exists or not.
And yeah, so right. So essentially, I want for this kind of tutorial first concentrate to show that existence of non-malleable codes is a non-obvious thing. And you know, just like in coding theory, first Shannon probably proved existence. It was probabilistic method, and then people started to construct. So here, we'll give you some maybe constructions, and then you can like you know roll up your sleeves and try to optimize the rate. But indeed, RAID, in some of the work, hopefully I'll get to mention that work, RAID optimization of the RAID was very, very important after the initial results. So let's do the second case. And you saw where privacy is used, right? So you saw why it was probabilistic. So the second case was the attacker overwrites a little bit more than half, but still, you know, but keeps more than the privacy threshold, right? So in this case, this is the core of the argument. That's where one quarter comes in. So let me try to give you the idea. So by Plotkin bound, well, let's say forget the Plotkin bound. So let's see how many consistent code words are there. So how many like things would be consistent with this code word? Will decode to non-bottom. So this thing is kind of fixed. So this essentially, all those things, because they have this fixed part, essentially they're giving you an error correcting codes of block lengths n over 2 instead of n, right, because this part is fixed. So I'm looking how many of these kind of code words. So the red part is fixed. The only randomness is over the yellow part. Could decode to non-bottom. So I'm saying effectively, you can see that you get an error correcting code in the traditional sense of Blanc's length n over 2. And the distance is, previously it was due of n was more than a quarter. But now for this small guy, it's more than a half. And we know that by Plotkin bound, there are very few code words when the relative distance becomes more than a half. So therefore, there will be only constant number of code words, or maybe like logarithmic or something like that. But essentially, there will be very few consistent code words here, which could decode to non-bottom, right? Just because the attacker fixed so many things, and that's why I have such an aggressive setting. D of n is greater than a quarter. And in this case, by T privacy, but notice, even though any T of those positions are random and uniform, right? Any T of those positions random of uniform, maybe not n. So essentially, any of those, you get the probability by T privacy, the probability that this stuff, let's say I can take you know any two of those positions, agrees with one of these code words is at most 2 to the minus t, and there are so few of them, like a constant number, that you still get security. So essentially, in this case, yes, the probability that attacker get anything non-bottom is negligible. So in this case, what you do, you just output bottom, right? And you have exponentially high, you know, 1 minus negligible probability of succeeding. So this is kind of the key argument. You see it requires some knowledge of coding theory. So you know, even though I didn't make explicitly the restrictions on the number of errors, by looking at these kind of cases, I do it. So the third and fourth case, maybe I'll go a little bit faster. They're symmetric by just kind of looking at the difference between C minus C prime. I mean, fine, I'll do it. So the third case is a symmetric. And here we're saying, well, let's look at the difference between C star and C. And by kind of linearity, we'll just say, what is the chance that the attacker, that the difference, because the difference will decode a non-bottom message, and we can make the same kind of argument by T privacy. So I'll just go, oh yeah, and there is one cute observation that once you kind of do this thing, operation keep CI on C sub I corresponds to set to zero on this delta. So we can kind of use a previous analysis. So I'll go quickly, and the last case, I guess, and the last case, again, it's like the similar argument, and again, we use, in this case, when you look at this delta, these bits become uniformly random, and you just do the same thing. So, so I'll just, you know, as I said, the third and fourth cases are kind of symmetric, so I'll just kind of skipping them. So, so now we need such a linear correcting secret sharing scheme. And it turns out that that's actually non-trivial. For example, standard version of Shamir secret sharing scheme because of the alphabet issue will not give you this. Anyway, maybe I'll skip it. The point is you can do it. It requires some coding theory and some stuff. So in the interest of time, let me go to qualitative results. So
you read everything bitwise?
Yeah. So that the tampering was bitwise. The construction doesn't have to be bitwise. For the construction, all I have to tell you is a binary. I need to construct a binary linear recollecting secret sharing scheme with the following parameters. The distance has to be at least a quarter. That's kind of for binary case non-trivial, right? Because half is the maximum. And there has to be like enough randomness to give you a little bit of privacy. And for these parameters, it turns out, so the original construction was probabilistic because you don't need efficient decoding, but essentially, we know how to do it. It requires some more machinery. I don't want to spend time on this right now. Okay, so let me give you a little bit more of the overview. So I gave you an example of something non-trivial you can do. You know, you saw that it requires some tools of coding thing and so on, but the question is how far can we go? Right now we see that it's a useful notion. We can get at least something non-trivial, which we couldn't get previously. Can we do maybe all function families? That would be amazing. Well, unfortunately, this is kind of impossible. Here it's really impossible, unfortunately. Well, because for any function g that you want, assume you actually want to implement a function g in the ideal setting, you can always like decode, apply function g, and re-encode. Right? So that could be your real function f. So if you allow arbitrary tampering, here is how I implement a tampering g in the ideal model. Decode, apply function g, re-encode. And then, of course, if I do the real experiment, I'll just apply an arbitrary function g. So essentially, this becomes g sub all. So if I want all families here, I get also, finally, just there are limitations of what we can do. But still, and even some simpler f. I don't have time, but for example, there is a cute function, family f, which has found many applications. It's called a Klukahead family. So here, the memory is divided in two parts, C1 and C2. And you are allowed to tamper with them kind of first. It's like in a streaming model. First, you look at C1. You have to commit to tampering on C1. And then you look at C2, and you can do join tampering. But now it's too late to change C1. So essentially, you have to change C1 before seeing C2. That's the only restriction. And even this family is impossible because of a very subtle attack called the bottom attack. So the bottom attack is essentially the following functionality, where you can say, if I like the message, I keep it. If I don't like the message, I put bottom, right? Or I put some kind of garbage. So this is outside of our family of non-malleable function, because depending on the message, you do two different things. And for example, for this look-ahead family, it's very easy to see that you can do this tampering. So it shows that not everything is possible, so it's somewhat of a subtle question. But fortunately, there was a series of work, so you see it was not a completely trivial question to settle existence. But for example, we know that there exists non-malleable codes for very rich families. And in fact, the only thing we need to bound is the size of the family. So you know there are essentially 2^2 n functions total. So as long as the number of functions in your family is a little bit less, is like 2^2.9 n or something like that, then there exists a code, and the code has even a fantastic rate. So on the previous slide, I forgot to tell you, using this linear correcting secret sharing, we can make rate arbitrarily close to 1. I'm just not showing how, but you can actually do it. So here again, you can have rate very close to 1 as long as alpha is a little bit less than double exponential. And in fact, this is inefficient. And if f is only singly exponential, we can have actually an explicit construction. So maybe in the interest of time, I'll tell you the syntax of the construction. I will not tell you of the proof. So the way the construction kind of works is the following. So encoding of m consists of two parts. It consists of some kind of z and essentially tag of z. So, and what is z? Z is, you can view as like a one-time pad encryption of the message. So z is like you choose a random r, you one-time pad m with h of r, that's your z, and then you hash the whole thing. So for appropriate functions, h and h prime. And how appropriate, essentially, the way you choose this h and h prime is at random from a family of log cardinality of pairwise independent hash functions. And then you show for majority of choices it works. So I will not tell you more, but it's really cool. I mean, this, especially the last paper, cleaned up the previous papers, and it kind of presented a certain level of generality. So let's ignore the low-level things. The high-level things is non-malleable codes, even of very good rate, exist for essentially all families as long as these families don't contain all functions, right? Or almost all functions. All right, so. Let me see if there are, I certainly didn't give you enough details to understand why this kind of works, but.
So the code needs h and h prime.
Yes, so this is technically this construction you can interpret it two ways. One way, there exists efficient h and h primes that you hardwire, is just this, we cannot like fix them. We don't know how to certify that given H prime. So either you have a code in what is called common reference trained model, so you fix, you pick at random H and H prime, you publish them, and with very high probability you are right, but they cannot be tempered. Or you kind of, I don't know, maybe some smarter mathematicians will tell us exactly what H and H prime are. But in this level of generality, it's hard to do something better because it's independent of F. You know, it only depends on the cardinality. But for the next last 10 minutes of the talk, I'll tell you actually something explicit for a very useful family. So this is like the last part of the talk. I will talk about something that attracted a lot of attention. A very particular family which has a lot of applications. It's called the split state model. Or the split state function, which is a generalization of a bitwise tempering function, where the memory is partitioned in T part, or if you wish, the code word is split into T parts, where T is a parameter. It could be as low as 2 and as high as the number of bits in the encoding. And you have to independently tamper with everything, with every part of the memory. So this is a family. This is a family of ST, standing for split state model. All right, and it includes, if you think about it, includes error correcting codes. Error detecting codes, constants, bitwise tempering, etc. And in some applications, it's naturally enforceable, right? You have like two hard drives, maybe you put them on two parts of the computer, or you have two different people, and somehow you assume that those people cannot be corrupted together. Maybe they don't know who they are. So we can ask, what about non-malleable codes in this split state model? So essentially, the generalization is T could be very low, right? That's what I'm trying to do. So first of all, let's recall the definition. It's the same picture. So this is a real model. You split it, you decode, and you want to make sure that M star is an M or a constant. All right? Good. And one natural application is kind of acute. So I'm throwing the word non-malleable here. You can think of this as a non-malleable secret sharing, where with the following guarantee, you like pick N people. They don't know who they are. You take your secret, you split it into N pieces, or you encode it. Give those N pieces to N different people, T different people. They don't know who they are. Maybe they're like in different parts of the world. You need all of them to reconstruct the secret, but each of them is like unreliable. If each of them kind of tampers independently, you get something unrelated with a message or not identity or something. So it's just a name. And T equals 2 is the hardest, of course. We know T equals 1 is impossible because it's all tampering, but T equals 2 is kind of the hardest. And also, if you look at the size of the family, it's roughly speaking like that. So as long as T is greater than 2, they exist. Okay. Unfortunately, because it's kind of double exponential, not single, the existence construction is not efficient. It has public parameters, and it's not efficient. So you'd like to kind of make it efficient and good. So there has been a lot of work on this subject that turned out to be non-trivial kind of thing. So I'll just tell you the punchline is, recently as of last year, we finally have a constant rate non-malleable codes in this split state model with two servers. I don't know what the constant are. We rely on some results in additive combinatorics. So it has some bizarre, I don't know. So the constants are not known. We do have something of linear rate where the constant is like maybe 5 or 6. For constant rate is kind of unknown. But the key tool, and that's the only thing that, I have like 5 minutes to. So the key tool is this tempering reduction that I put on the first slide. This is like the key tool. So let me tell you a little bit of the philosophy. And the punchline, so this is my first slide, if you remember. This is this notion of tempering reduction from F to G. It's just in the beginning of my talk, I went to exploring different Fs and G. And here I want to explore the other property, which is very simple to see, is the transitivity. Which is kind of obvious. If you know how to reduce F to G and then G to H, then by composing, you trivially reduce F to H. So this tells you that maybe starting with a really complicating F, instead of going right away jumping to this, we can kind of have a sequence of steps where the first is like layers of one, and each step will kind of help to simplify it a little bit, and then you can rewind and do the second step and so on. So in particular, so this is, I probably will not be able to tell you too much about this, but we'll see how far I go. But this is like in a sequence of papers, in the first, like in Stock 14, we did kind of this line of reductions to build the first non-malleable codes with like, I'll actually tell you the parameters. So in our first paper, we had the first polynomial time non-malleable codes in the split state model. The rate was like k to the 7. I do want to mention something which relate, you know, follow-up papers when they not criticize, but they kind of point at this adventure of our paper, always forget to mention. So we do have a conjecture which is relatively natural, under which even the original construction will be like linear rate. The conjecture is related to this polynomial Freeman-Ruge conjecture. So under polynomial Freeman-Ruge conjecture, we get rate k square, and under a stronger conjecture, which we make in the paper, but it's kind of clean, we get linear rate. So, but of course, we want a provable thing, and that we get in this other line of reductions, which kind of has other tools. So I'll just tell you maybe this is, okay, so maybe let's very quickly, I'll show you one reduction, like over here. This is like a very cool thing, and this is like a theorem of independent interest. I'll just take 5 minutes to show you this and maybe skip the other things. All right, so quickly simplifying assumptions. So I will mainly focus on the decoding procedure deck. And this is like one advantage. It's easy to remember, because if you look at the picture, the decoding procedure, it kind of goes from, oh, where is the slide? It goes from the domain of F to domain of G. So it's kind of easy to remember that when we reduce one family by specifying decoding procedure, I have to tell you something which goes from domain of F to domain of G. And our encoding will always be a random C such that decoding equals to M. And this creates some problems with the, you know, encoding might not be efficient, but I'm not going, we can get around it, so I'll just, I'm not going to mention it. And also, I will also argue non-malleability for random message, M. I'll denote it U, for uniformly random message, which is already very non-trivial. And it turns out there is a generic transformation which loses something exponential, but it's not too bad in our things. It goes from random message to worst case message. All right, so, so this is like the last technical slide, and I think it's a cool theorem of independent interest. You don't need to know anything about non-malleable codes. It's just an interesting theorem. So here is my... well, actually, here I lied. I'm actually going to tell you how to do encoding. But really, the main function is the decoding, and the decoding function is the inner product of a finite field. So I have a P which is large enough prime, so I'm looking at the n-dimensional vector space over FP, and my encoding is random L and R, whose inner product is my random message. Right? So the decoding is the inner product. All right? Very simple, over a big enough field. Very important non-binary. Okay? So this is the inner product lemma, which, to be honest, it stated very simply, and I was sure it's false until we proved it, okay? But so this is what it says. It says that if you look at the joint distribution of the real message, essentially, you know, because the message is uniform, think about you choose L and R uniformly at random. So you have a random L and R. So this is, gives you the real message U. But now the attacker tempers. He changes L to F of L, G to G of R, and you look at the tempered message. And what we are saying that essentially the only thing the attacker can do is a convex combination of F and temperings, where A and B are independent of the message. It only depends on the function F and G. So for any F and G, there are this, you know, constants, well, which is distribution, but there is this joint distribution of constants A and B that essentially the only tempering the attacker can do is linear tempering. And if you think about it, of course, it's easy to see that the attacker can do linear tempering, because inner product is a linear kind of function. But the fact is that the attacker can only can do linear tempering, it's, it was kind of very surprising. And the proof was indeed kind of complicated, unfortunately, but the statement is not. So, the question is how low is n in order for the statement to be true, right? How many dimensions? So it's easy to see that n equals 1 or 2 is like wrong. In this case, you know, the attacker can do kind of much more in such low dimensions. So we can prove it unconditionally for kn equals k to the 6, and that gives us, because this is another security parameter that gives us provable k to the 7, there is this polynomial, something which I don't know much about. It's just my co-author Shahar Lovett kind of assured us. So under polynomial Riemann-Fruge conjecture, we just use kind of one statement. We can provably get it to n to the order 1k, and we just make our conjecture. We don't have a name for it. We don't have a break, but maybe for n equals like 200 or something like that, or, you know, I don't know, a million, it's true as well.
So the A is a matrix, right?
No, it's a number. So this is a finite field. So this L and R are vectors, and U is an element of FP.
A is just
a scalar. The scalar. L is a scalar, A is a scalar, B is a scalar, yeah. So here there are two scalars, and here there are two inner products of two vectors. So the statement is really simple. And you know, as I believe the result could be used in other contexts already. So some kind of neat applications is also unfortunately conditional to privacy amplification that Leo talked about. It's like new approach to designing privacy amplification protocol. So anyway, I think it's a cool statement. So I'll jump to summary and conclusions, skipping the second part of this thing. So anyway, it's very cool. All right, maybe just the last bullet I say, and then I'll move to this thing. So what are the tools? Why it relates to the serrated combinatorics? So the first tool is simple. We can say, well, either the join distribution is essentially two uniform messages, either the attacker did, you know, essentially change it to something unrelated, or there is this Vazirani lemma, there is a reason why the join distribution is not uniform. There must be some constants A and B, such that this linear combination is far from uniform. This is kind of follows from something called Vazirani lemma. This is easy to prove. And then hard work, some kind of manipulations and so on. I'll tell you the last bullet. It just shows that either F and G, in this case, either one of them is linear. So in this case, A is a matrix, not a scalar. Either it's, you know, the tempering is linear, or, and hard work shows that if this sum is far from uniform, there exists either F and G is linear on a constant fraction, or not constant, non-trivial fraction of the domain. How non-trivial depends on the parameters. And in particular, the main parameter we use is this kind of linearity test of a GFP. We need some more generalized version, but the basic form is the following really cool theorem from additive combinatorics. It says, for a function f, if you pick L and R at random, and you know that with non-trivial probability f of L minus f of L prime is equal f of L minus L prime, obviously linear function satisfied. A linearity test says, indeed, then f is close to linear. There exists a matrix A. That's where we kind of get our linear functions from this. So essentially, we do some manipulations to reduce it to this, and then we apply this kind of cool stuff from additive combinatorics, which was only recently proven by Sanders. So all right. So let me go to. So I just gave you like a little bit of a flavor how to use non-malleable reductions. Oh, sorry. Sorry. Yeah. Yes. Well, here, so essentially we need to do a little bit of more manipulations here. We need to use some also leftover hash lemma at some point. But essentially using, so this is actually not very hard, but unfortunately I cannot put it on the board. There is a little bit of kind of calculations, and I need to define some other function f, and I need a slightly generalized form. But essentially, you're completely right. This translates to the fact that because it's far from uniform, we kind of reduce it, you know, we show that linearity test must work. And therefore, we extract a linear function. But this is like the heart of the paper.
But this is kind of minimalistic, according to you. Are you only agreeing, passing linearity test with small probability?
On a very small probability, yes. And this epsilon prime, of course, the game is how long you can make epsilon prime. And this kind of Sanders result is the first. So I think this Riemann-Fruge conjecture would make epsilon prime a thing like polynomial in epsilon. And you can make it quasi-polynomial. With a proof that was approved by Sanders. So this already, I think the statement is kind of clean, but you know, the proof is one of those things. So yeah, I'll conclude. So let me skip the rest and I'll just tell you other stuff. So it's just there is some other reductions that we did in the paper to achieve constant rate stuff. There were many extensions. I will not tell you so far, but the only thing that I will tell you, I'm just in the last conclusion slides. So ever since the introduction, people realized that this is a useful notion. And they consider all kinds of extensions of the basic notion. The most important, which has the most application, is this notion of a continued thing, which is not a one-time shot game, but the attacker can repeatedly tamper like multiple times. And you have to pay something and so on. But this is like the most important in terms of applications perspective, because it's very rare that there is only one tampering. So if you get the signature card, you can try it multiple times and do things like that. And I believe many more applications to come. People build this thing for more families. So this is like a very actively growing area. All the references are in the last like 2 years, or like 2-3 years. It kind of really exploded, so it's probably not up to date. But I think there are a lot of exciting questions, and obviously information theory perspective would be great. There are more applications. This is like next to last slide. And I hope more to come. So most obvious application is tamper resilient security, which is a signature card application that I told you. But also there are some bizarre, strange applications which you wouldn't expect it. The main extension of, CCAC or non-malleable encryption. If you have a non-malleable encryption of one bit, how to build non-malleable encryptions of many bits. And it's kind of very natural. It's just you take the message, you encode it using non-malleable code, and encrypt it bit by bit. And with appropriate amount of work, you can prove it, but you need exactly some kind of continuous version of non-malleable code, and we can play with parameters and so on. And recently, there was this really exciting paper the authors, I think R is Richardson, P is maybe Pendy, I forgot who G is. But it's like an exciting thing about something called non-malleable commitments. It's a notoriously hard area. Like some people, like Rafael Paz, like made a career on these kind of papers. And so this thing kind of, I mean, it's not a simple paper, but it's a conceptually simple way to kind of make this textbook non-malleable commitments in three rounds using non-malleable code. So that is kind of very surprising. Yeah.
Goyal.
Good. Oh yeah, that's Vipul. Okay. Okay, so Vipul, sorry, yeah, no, Vipul, of course, yeah. Sorry, it's like I'm trying to only be late for, all right, and hopefully more to come. All right, so this is end. So we define non-malleable codes. It has many applications of flavors. There are constructions for many families. The applications beyond temporal protections. And, there are many open questions, so stop.
Could you repeat, please, the definition of a non-malleable
code? Sure. That's always the best question at the end of the talk. I'll gladly do it if I'm allowed to. So I'll just put it on the picture. So this is the definition, but maybe this is a picture. So it's just what we are saying is you want to design an encoding and decoding function such that for any tampering f, the result of this real experiment is as if you simply either copied the message or you overwrote it with a constant. So this is the definition. So you have a family of capital F, yeah? And the guarantee is that
every small f,
yeah,
this must be true.
There exists in the full generality a convex combination of G's from this very simple family of either constants or this, but they cannot be dependent on the message. So there is no message here. For any f, I can tell you what the G is, and then now the message comes, and this looks like this. There is no asymptotics. Usually, for every parameter, there will be a fixed error probability epsilon.
Fixed size.
Usually we kind of parameterize it just to get like dependence. But usually, it's like if m is like k bits, this will be like 2^-k/5 or something like that. That will be like statistical distance. The probability is only over the choice of encoding.
Yes, but I mean.
This is statistical distance. Yeah. Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, no probability in the chain. You could consider it will be a weaker notion. I mean, it will be maybe you can get better results by putting probability in the channel. But yeah, here the only probability is encoding. Here the only probability is a mixture of G's. That's only.
I'm trying to understand you. There was the comment about when the size of F is less than 2^(2^(alpha)n).
Yes. Yeah.
So that seemed a bit strange because in the example you called F copy.
Yeah.
It seemed like the size was much smaller.
Oh, it's like it's very small. And the F copy is like polynomial. It's like it's 3^(n). So for every bit there is 3^(n). In this case we have an existence result. If it's only single exponential, we have efficient constructions without noise.
Is there some connection with Sudan decoding and
with Sudan decoding? Implicitly, because I guess some of the constructions of
you're getting very close to 1 - alpha,
yeah.
It seems vaguely like it's somehow connected to the list decoding.
Well, in this construction it's not explicit. I mean, I actually showed you the construction. It's very simple. The proof doesn't use, I mean, it uses probabilistic methods and some kind of calculations. It doesn't use list decoding. I would imagine like linear correcting, secret sharing stuff, I think somewhere inside it might use related techniques to list decoding because you're pushing like above a quarter. But as
I said, yeah.
I think Sudan decoding, the way I see it, is just there are more errors that you can uniquely decode. So, I mean, in this sense, but as far as I know, that's where the similarity ends. But I wouldn't be surprised that if some constructions, we need this very aggressive regime of least decoding. I mean, if you wish, like, I don't know, the argument this Plotkin bound was kind of a little bit like that, going in a different direction by checking the number of consistent code words. So I wouldn't be surprised. I mean, as I said, error correcting codes play an important role in this kind of case analysis, but I really think it's a qualitatively different object which requires a different way to think about it. But this is my experience with it, so.
All right, so let's maybe take further discussion offline. Thank you, Yevgeniy.